Good evening, everyone. Call to order for the Lower Makefield Township Planning Commission meeting for October 12th, 2020. The first item on our agenda is an approval of the minutes from the September 14th, 2020 meeting. Did the other members have an opportunity to review? Are there any questions or comments? And if not, any motions to approve?
I wasn't there, so I'll just stay out of it.
No comments. I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes.
Yes, I reviewed them and I'll second.
All right. All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Minutes are approved. The next item on our agenda this evening is number 678, Pennsylvania American Water Company. For the Oxford Valley Road Booster Pump Station, they are seeking a special exception. And do we have a representative from Pennsylvania American Water with us?
Yes, looks like someone in the room.
Very good. Good evening.
I'm Craig Darris. I'm the project manager for Pennsylvania American Water. And we're here tonight with our engineer. His name's Jason Leonard from HRG to present the Oxford Valley High Service Booster Pump Station replacement. We need some approvals on that. I will turn it over to Jason to go over that.
Do I have the ability to share my screen?
You should.
Okay. Would that be easiest if I pulled up maybe some PDFs to show everyone?
I think it would, yes.
I think it'd be okay. Big help. Thanks.
Bear with me one second. Okay, let me know when you guys can see my screen here.
There we go.
So Pennsylvania American Water is looking to construct a above ground booster pump station at their existing site located along North Oxford Valley Road. This booster pump is going to replace an existing below ground booster pump station. The current property is made up of actually two parcels that we are proposing to consolidate into one. We are... And I'll pull up the site plan here so you can see the proposed work. this is the location of the proposed booster pump station. additionally, as part of the project, we are proposing to realign the existing driveway as it currently runs off onto the township's property. So we are proposing to realign that, get it all on P American Water's property, and use that to access the site. We are, as was mentioned before, we are needing to be covered under a special exception. So we are looking for recommendation from the Planning Commission to the Zoning Hearing Board for that special exception. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have about the site, the layout, anything that you might have.
Just a quick question. Is fundamentally what you're trying to do here similar to the project you're doing up on Quarry Road? You're just taking a pump and moving it above ground, putting in a new building?
That is, it's exactly the same. This station is actually even older than right. The one we were doing on Quarry Road. This is like 40 years old. So it's right. It's seeing the same deterioration that the one on Quarry Road is.
Okay. And is this like right next to the water tower? Like, where is this?
Yeah, you can even see that water tower on the,
all right,
the
so
plan.
That's what. Right. Okay.
Yep. Right there.
That's what I thought that was.
So this location is south of the ball fields that were constructed north of the community center, where the water tower is back up there in the woods, where basically all you see from the road is the driveway leading into the site, which they're going to keep basically in the same location except for where veers off their property. They're just going to continue down that little neck property so that they're all legit, and then take away that gravel, return it to grass, and then put the area back down. And this is going to be paved, correct?
Just for a portion of it is going to be paved. The remainder is going to stay gravel.
We're paving the entrance to just beyond where the proposed township's bike path is going over, because I believe that bike path will be paved.
Okay.
So we wanted to, that's what we're doing just to keep the impervious surface down. We decided just to pave to that far extent so that the bike path can go seamlessly right over.
Is there currently an easement where the road is going on township property at the moment?
There is not. We're proposing a temporary construction easement for that realignment of the road on the township property.
Okay. So it's just been sort of, it's okay. The township's just been, you can use this, but there's been no easement.
Correct. That's my understanding.
Probably just cut the corner and didn't go up far enough before they veered over.
Yeah, I'm not in the local operations, but I'm not even sure we realized that until we saw this survey. So we do apologize for that.
So, excuse me, this is between the ball field and the community center?
Yeah.
And there's a driveway that goes back there right now, correct?
Yeah, this is the existing driveway here.
Yeah.
You can see from North Oxford Valley Road comes up and connects to the site here.
Okay. And Jim, just so I'm clear, what exactly do we have to, what are we approving as Planning Commission, or not approving or recommending, like what specific aspect of this should we be focused on?
Okay, there are two parts to this whole process. One, they have requested a special exception and also, I believe, a variance from the Zoning Hearing Board. That is under their purview to either grant or deny those that request for the relief that's sought. Right. However, the Planning Commission's role for the special exception part is that you need to prepare an advisory report or give your comments on the location of such use in relation to the needs and growth pattern of the area, and where appropriate, with reference to the adequacy of the site area and arrangement of buildings, driveways, parking areas, off-street truck loading spaces, and other pertinent features of the site plan. So it's essentially sort of like looking at a sketch plan and saying that this driveway configuration seems to make sense. They have a turnaround area, they have a place to park. Or if you see any issues with that, you should give that as your advisory opinion to the Zoning Hearing Board.
All right. And what I'm seeing here is essentially the only change is, I think we're talking about, is taking that curve out of the driveway and keeping the driveway all on the correct property lines, and redoing the pump house the same way essentially they did up on Quarry Road. Is that right?
They also have a small stormwater management area just to the north of where the building is, or to the west of where the parking area is, and that little area. And they do have a small area of clearing that's proposed with that.
All right, so they're clearing a small area, but also helping bring another piece of area where the driveway, the old driveway is, let it go back to whatever we want it to.
Correct.
Okay.
Jason had mentioned that there's two parcels and consolidating into one here. Does that need to occur before the special exception can be granted?
Actually, in this case, those two parcels are classified as one tax parcel by the Board of Assessment at the county level. It may be that the deed shows it as two separate parcels. It's assessed for tax purposes as one parcel.
Barbara, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I did. I came across this just recently involving something else with PA American Water. I don't know if they want to try to do some sort of corrective deed or something, because the property is actually titled in the name of their predecessor, Yardley Water and Power Company. And it becomes very cumbersome when you're granting easements and things of that nature to try to grant it to PA American Water, but the property is titled in a different entity's name. So I don't know if their legal department wants to do something to try to correct that so everything is accurate.
Greg, did you want to?
I can certainly bring that up with them. I know usually Yardley was PA American before I came on board almost 20 years ago. So I'm not even sure when that took place, but I was also part of an acquisition, which was Citizens Utilities, and our deeds, some of them still do say Citizens Utilities, but I guess the agreement of sale or whatever kind of encompasses all that. But I will definitely follow up with our counsel and see what they want to do about that.
And I only bring it up because it came into play with something else totally unrelated. But it seems that a lot of the parcels in the township owned by PA Water Company were previously titled in the name of Yardley Water and Power.
Okay.
And Barbara, if we do proceed with a recommendation, would we want to incorporate as part of the recommendation that, if appropriate, a name change?
Yeah.
Consideration be made?
Yeah, either file a new deed or a notice of a successor in ownership of or whatever.
My only other question was with regards to buffers, and maybe this is a question for Andy, but anybody who has commentary on this. If I understand it correctly, some of the above ground improvements are moving closer to the property line. Does this still satisfy all buffer requirements? I couldn't tell from that map, but I thought looking at it previously, there's a house on the other side of the property line as we approach the top of the map we were just looking at, but I might be misoriented here. Because obviously we see, yeah, it would be the reverse here. Is there a house at the bottom of or below what we're looking at? And does.
So it's a community center.
Yeah. So no, there's no house there. The proposed building is outside of the yard requirement. So there is space there for a buffer. There's an existing buffer on the adjacent property. The only thing that I would say where we may wish to require additional planting would be along the north side where
baseball field
is adjacent to the fields.
Yeah.
They are proposing some clearing in that area.
What is that structure right there by the water tower? What is that?
That might be a maintenance shed. EAWC can correct me.
So actually on this site, if you're looking, I can't see Zoom. Pennsylvania American actually blocks Zoom. But Jason did send me. So if he has the site plan up, immediately to the right of the tank is the station that I think we're replacing that's below grade. And then the more square looking one is actually a different booster station that feeds into a different area. Oh. So we got a lot of stuff going on this property. And then there's also a generator by that booster station.
Yeah, and I was clearly mistaken. There's obviously no house in this vicinity. Andy, regardless of our special exception recommendation, they still need to meet the requirements of the buffer under the ordinance. So our vote on that will have no impact on their requirements there whatsoever.
That's true. I believe they are requesting a variance for that.
Okay.
That's correct. Yeah, we're needing to clear some area for stormwater management and for realigning the driveway. So, yeah, we are requesting a variance for the type 2 buffer, I believe is what it's called.
I don't know if this is the appropriate time to discuss that, but is there some wiggle room with that? Is that, I mean, could you put in like an infiltration trench along the north side of the driveway that would eliminate the surface basin and thereby still meet your stormwater requirement? I mean, are you willing to work with us to meet the stormwater requirement in other ways so that you don't have to clear trees?
Yeah, I mean, I think we try to minimize the tree clearing as much as possible. It's just sort of dimensional restraints. I don't know if there would be enough room to put in some sort of gravel trench that would get us the same volume that we're currently getting with the proposed basin. But it's certainly something we're willing to work to find an agreeable solution with the township. You know, we're kind of in the position where we're trying to meet one requirement, but hence are kind of hamstrung on another requirement.
How big is this proposed building?
I don't have those dimensions right here at my fingertips, but it would be very similar in size to the Quarry Road, which was 12 foot wide by 35 feet long, I believe.
Yeah, it looks like this is closer to, just based on what I'm scaling off, 16 by 40 roughly.
Okay, so that's the pumps in this building are actually almost twice the size of the ones at Quarry Road, so that would make sense.
Okay.
I just have a quick question before we leave that last picture that was up. And I don't know if it's just the way that the white lines of the property are superimposed on the photo, but it almost looks like the road is not just the turn is not on the property, but not this picture, the one that was just up before this one. It made it look like the road was completely not in the property, or the driveway, I should say.
Yeah, the one with the satellite view.
Yeah.
Okay. That is a tax map level mapping. It is not correct. Basically, that's just a tax map rendering, and those lines are off by about 30 feet or so based on their survey.
Okay, because that would explain it. It looked like none of the road was within the tax map.
Yeah, we actually have the same issue with the, we're getting an easement from Pennsylvania American Water path that'll be crossing over that stem that goes out to Oxford Valley Road. And their map also shows it off like this, deed plottings. And I questioned this. They said, well, we just do it based on the deed plottings and easements wherever it crosses their property, don't worry about the picture. And it's the same with this. It's except for that part that curves around that is on our property, on township property, the rest of it is within that right of way that is theirs.
Thanks.
And will there be any paved area for parking?
No.
Yeah, we essentially just have a turnaround area. It's not necessarily going to be used for, it's not, you know, parking layout, you know, per se, but just more of a turnaround area for trucks.
And how many vehicles do we have there at any one time?
Possibly two, but this is an unmanned station. So, it's just a visit to, you know, do the normal system checks that they do a couple times a week. So unless there's some type of repair needed, that we would have a contractor taking care of, which could be a couple vehicles. but it's definitely wouldn't be on a long-term basis.
Right.
And is the Quarry Road one, is that gravel?
No, that is actually going to be paved.
Okay.
And that's,
that was, you know, that's a relatively. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Go ahead, Craig.
I was just saying that was one that's coming off of it's a pretty short driveway
right.
to begin with, and it's coming right off, you know, pretty highly traveled road. And that was the main reason we have absolutely nothing there at this point. We kind of just drive off onto the shoulder. So we were just trying to make that a much better scenario than what it was.
I guess I, for one, don't really have an issue with the being gravel just because it's not intended for anyone to stay parked there for any significant amount of time. I don't know if Andy or Jim, you see that differently than me, but or anyone else, but that doesn't seem like a big issue to me. Especially it's back in the woods.
Yeah, I don't see it as a major concern just because of the light use that it would get. There is language in the ordinance about site lighting that might be pertinent to this discussion. Basically, special exception applications should meet that all public, commercial, industrial parking, loading, access, or service areas shall be adequately illuminated at night while in use, and that such lighting, including sign lighting, shall be arranged so as to protect the highway and the neighboring properties from direct glare or hazardous interference of any kind. So that might be language that we want to recommend to the Zoning Hearing Board.
One thing to note, Andy and everyone else, that this will still be going through the land development approval process at a later date. So
okay.
Here, as I stated before, what your scope is, you know, does it make sense what they're doing? If you feel that lighting should be addressed now, that's something that should be addressed now. But other than that, it's basically sort of an advisory opinion on the matter heard before the Zoning Hearing Board, noting that it will be coming back to you as a land development.
Okay. All right. So some of the details we're talking about, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves probably because there's not a specific proposal per se.
Well, there is a proposal and I think Andy's already reviewed that. That's why he's
okay.
The comments on the like the more details of the site plan. But for now, it's just basically, do you think this special exception makes sense? Or do you want to put any specific stipulations or recommendations on the approval if granted by the Zoning Hearing Board related to the special exception?
Okay. So I guess would it be, I guess, from and what I'm hearing and what I've heard in this so far, it sounds like, at least from my perspective, I'd approve it with a couple of conditions. One, get the name on the deed fixed. And the second, minimize any buffer variance impact in the planning process as it goes through. I don't know, something to that effect. Am I missing anything?
No, I think Andy's point about the lighting that
no lighting
revisit. Well, I think that's when it goes through land development, that's the appropriate time to address that.
Right.
So yeah, I agree with your take on that, Adrian.
Okay. Anyway, I make the motion if anyone could come up with the right words for me.
So it would be, if I may, a motion to recommend approval of the request for a special exception subject to the realignment of the existing driveway as presented, with the township providing a temporary construction easement for that realignment, and record the necessary instruments in order to clarify the current title ownership of the affected parcel.
Okay. I'll make that motion.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed? Come. Motion passes. Craig and Jason, thank you very much.
Thank you for your time.
All right. Appreciate thanks, guys.
Have a good night.
Everyone.
Bye-bye.
Next item on the agenda is number 679, Bed and Breakfast Boarding Special Exception for 3 Ridge Avenue.
Mr. Majewski.
The property owner at 3 Ridge Avenue has requested a special exception from the Zoning Hearing Board to allow a bed and breakfast at their property located at 3 Ridge Avenue, or the alternative, to have a boarding use be allowed on the property. Let me share my screen real quickly. I'll show you where the property is. It's the house that is shown with the sort of reddish roof on this picture. If you went down the road, it's a bright yellow painted house right now. It's at the corner of Ridge Avenue and actually I forget the name of the other street right now. The borderline of Morrisville runs down the road. On the right side of the picture is Morrisville Borough. And on the left side of the road is Lower Makefield Township. And actually, you can see on the graphic a black line that runs through showing the approximate location of the property. For a bed and breakfast, there are a number of requirements that need to be met, and the applicant will need to make that at the Zoning Hearing Board. Once again, as a special exception, the Planning Commission has certain issues they have to do, and that is to have an advisory report with respect to the location of such use in relation to the needs and growth pattern of the area, and where appropriate with to the adequacy of the site area and arrangement of buildings, driveways, parking areas, off-street truck loading spaces, and other pertinent features of the site plan. This is an existing single-family house. I'll show you it on an aerial, which maybe you can see a little bit better. It has a short driveway coming off of Ridge Avenue. You can see the red car in the one graphic here. It has a two-car garage and has a sort of a narrow backyard here. It's almost like a side yard the way it's laid out. And this is what the applicant is proposing. For a bed and breakfast use, there are a number of requirements for that use, that it be listed on the National Register or be designated as historic by the Board of Supervisors and maintained in accordance with the standards for rehabilitation and guidelines for rehabilitating historic buildings, that no more than 4 persons occupy a guest room, that it have a minimum floor area of 3,500 square feet, and there's several other requirements that are part of this. And the applicant, also one thing that's relevant to the Planning Commission is that the parking area shall be screened with a type 4 buffer area in accordance with the buffer requirements of Article 16 of the Township Code. I don't know if you guys have any questions.
Make sure I understand. Is there anything in here that doesn't meet the strict requirements you just sort of laid out?
Yes.
Okay, what is
it? I believe they're deficient on several of the requirements for the property. The fact that it's not designated as a historic structure, that the building size does not meet the area, They've submitted no plan on how they intend to buffer the parking area, and several other issues may be in contention also.
Okay. Is the property owner in attendance or?
No.
Okay.
And not to sway this board's review, but it has been an ongoing issue with the property owner about the current use of the property, which does not meet the requirements of the applicable ordinance or property maintenance code. And that has been going on for at least 1, if not 2 years now.
Can you please say more about what you mean by current use of the property?
Yeah.
So at one point, the township was informed that the property owner had no less than 6 people living in the residence, some of which were living in the basement area that was not fully developed to accommodate bedrooms. He has been cited several times. Apparently, the property owner takes it upon himself to add certain additions and structures to the premises without the appropriate permits, and has again been cited by the township. In order to be able to have multiple residents at the property, he has decided to opt to try to get a special exception for either a bed or breakfast or approval for boarding, although he is not meeting all of the specific requirements of the conditions or regulations for either of those two uses. There have been numerous complaints lodged with the township by nearby residents of a constant flow of people coming in and out, almost similar to the prior application a little while ago about another property being used as a bed and breakfast. And in light of that situation, the property owner opted not to appear tonight, but simply to allow the board to look at its application on its face and then proceed with the zoning hearing, which is scheduled next week.
Just as an FYI, I think it's Greenway Avenue is the intersection.
Yeah.
Barbara, you had mentioned that not only were there items that were not satisfied to make it a bed and breakfast, but there were items that were not satisfied to allow it to be a boarding house. Could you share with us what those are?
I don't think he has the appropriate size requirements that are necessary. It also says it should not have the minimum net lot area is supposed to be 16,000 square feet. I don't know if he meets that requirement. I'm trying to see. According to the Board of Assessment, it's 0.472. Might be close.
Yeah.
It says no additional rooms may be constructed for this purpose. It's kind of hard to tell if he has constructed more rooms. He's been installing other areas. And I don't know if he's actually created more cooking facilities. I know that there were certain things being done to the interior of the house that he was told to remove, which I believe he did, but I don't know if there's any more things that are being constructed. I know he's put in like a porch roof type overhang without a permit, and I think he's also installed a patio area. Okay. And the other thing of concern is it says not more than 2 boarders in the house, and he has at times had upwards of maybe 6 to 8 people residing there. So it could be an issue as to compliance with the limitation of the number of boarders that could be at the residence.
Okay.
Are there, Jim, any existing lawful bed and breakfasts in Lower Makefield? Do you know?
Check on that. And I don't believe we do have any.
A related question, but not necessarily on point, but related. I know a lot of communities have developed ordinances about Airbnbs. I don't know if Floor Makefield's thinking about it, has done it. I'm just not aware of anything that may have taken place locally, but is that something that's being kicked around at this point?
I believe it has been, and it has been addressed. There was a situation about a year and a half or 2 years ago where there was a property on Yardley Makefield Road being used as a bed and breakfast via advertisement on Airbnb. And as a result of the case law that had been passed at that time, township was not, could, did not prevail, and the property owner was able to use it continually as an Airbnb. And I believe after that, there were some amendments to the ordinance with respect to a bed and breakfast.
We do have an ordinance that does regulate that. This property, they actually had a permit for a while to run an Airbnb. However, they violated almost every condition of the Airbnb permit, and their permit was revoked by the township.
What about a legal boarding house? Is there anything like that in Lower Makefield right now that you know of? Yeah.
We do have a number of properties that are legitimized and do have zoning hearing board approval boarding use.
Are they in residential developments similar to the nature of this, or are they standalone improvements that are not necessarily in organized developments? Like what we're picturing here with Three Ridge Ave.
The ones I'm aware of are not within a development such as this, or the sort of odd parcel that they may add two houses on the property. One property now that's several hundred years old. It was an old Wells Fargo stagecoach stop site, and they have a boarding use there where one house where the residents reside and another house where they have boarders. A few situations like that where it's typically larger properties that are involved.
This house was sold in August of 2018. Have these activities, to your knowledge, just been going on since that time, or did they predate that last sale? To the extent we know of, either the Airbnb activities or any other activities that have been cited since. But we're talking last 1 or 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
They're all new activities.
And to our knowledge, does the applicant, is this his full-time residence?
Yes.
It is? I don't know.
I'm kind of without all of the other historical background and the other issues that may or may not be there, I'm kind of, we're not really a big border house bed and breakfast community, and there's specific rules in our ordinances right now around that, and I'm not inclined to have a discussion to change those rules right now. And I'm not inclined to approve anything that asks for any exceptions, let alone the number of exceptions that they're asking. I mean, the size of the lot, the size of the house, the buffering on the driveway, all those have really good purposes for this kind of application in a residential neighborhood. And I'm not inclined to sit here and say we should rewrite those, and I'm not inclined to say, in the first bed and breakfast request that we can all think of, we should make an exception to that.
So Jim, I'm sorry, excuse me.
Yeah, go ahead.
On the legal boarding houses that are in the township, is there a minimum time that the people are required to stay on the property, or how does that work?
Let me check real quickly.
No, it just says it must be full-time residents. I don't think there's anything, Jim, that per se is to a length of time.
So in these boarding houses, people can be coming and going quite frequently then?
I believe so. Mm-hmm.
And is there any assurance that there is compliance with, you know, Megan's Law type of requirements for boarders? Or
I do know that if somebody moves into a vicinity within a certain distance of a school or other facility of that nature, like a daycare or something, and they are on the Megan's list, they do have to register with the police department. I don't know, though, off the top of my head as to what else is done to ensure registration.
I mean, you have people coming and going fairly frequently in, you know, a boarding type situation that, you know, gives one pause for concern.
Part of the problem with the Megan's Law is it's done via the state, and there's not a lot that the township can do to modify it as it being a state law.
How many boarding houses are in the township? There's just two?
There's only two that I can think of off the top of my head, but people who have boarders.
So I guess I go back to what I was trying to say before is we have rules and I guess ordinances in place that regulate what houses should be able to do this kind of activity. And this doesn't seem like a case I'm inclined to say yes to any sort of exception to what our ordinance says.
I'd have to agree between the information we've been provided in the lack of ability to meet the requirements of the ordinance in combination with lack of compliance of prior attempts at similar activity, along with a lack of fit and feel of the residential neighborhood. I think that is, those are my concerns, and rather large. Don, Antonio, I'll obviously give you a chance to weigh in additionally. And then I think that if we have any public comments, I'm prone to want to hear from any individuals who may wish to weigh in from the public.
I agree with you.
The only thing I'd add is just the unpermitted additional construction that has taken place at the location is also troublesome. Yep. And shows a disregard for existing requirements, as is in addition to already using the property for this purpose without seeking prior approval.
Good. So do we have any public comment this evening?
There's no public comment.
Well, that's easy. Okay. What's the correct step forward administratively?
So this commission has three choices. One, recommend that the request for special exception for both bed and breakfast and or the boarding house be denied. Recommend that either one or both of the requests for special exception be approved, or take no further action.
Okay.
And just as a reminder, once again, the duties of the Planning Commission with respect to a special exception are to consider the location of such use in relation to the needs and growth pattern of the area, and where appropriate with reference to the adequacy of the site area and arrangement of buildings, driveways, parking areas, off-street truck loading spaces, and other pertinent features of the site plan.
Thank you, Jim.
Thanks. I can make a motion. I make a motion that we recommend denying both requests, exception requests on this.
I second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes. Very good. The last item on our agenda this evening is the Saldo Ordinance Amendment discussion. And give me one moment while I pull up. Adrian and I are on tap this week to discuss this item. I just want to pull up my notes. So this being the last item for our guideline discussion, what we found is that for the most part, we have covered virtually everything that we wanted to discuss in this landscape and hardscape discussion. A lot of it was covered, Dawn, in your section early on back in February or March, especially as to the hardscape. And then, Tony, additional items were covered, especially in parking, just because of the nature of the environmental or the green parking agenda that was circulated as well. So this is a fairly brief discussion. And Adrian, jump in. I'll do a little bit and then give you an opportunity to jump in as well.
Okay.
But as to landscape, I think our priorities and what we saw as ideal guidelines, especially as it pertains to sustainable landscaping, had the following seven ideas, tenets in mind. Number one, protect and enhance the visual appeal of Lower Makefield. Number two, contribute to high quality development. Number three, conserve water resources by using sustainable design and maintenance techniques and plant species that are low water use and regionally appropriate. Number four, avoid the use of invasive species. Number five, respect and enhance the hydrological patterns and protect water quality, conserve and recycle water in the landscape and reduce stormwater runoff in parking areas and other impervious areas. Six, improve air quality. Seven, buffer potentially incompatible neighboring land uses. And with regards to that invasive species, I'd also say that as a related item, when at all possible, to use landscaping materials which are locally sourced and are appropriate for this environment and geographically. So I'll pause there and Adrian, let you jump in.
Yeah, I mean, that pretty much covers everything we talked about. I think the one thing I guess I would maybe add or clarify is, you know, this is going to be a big area with a lot of public spaces and walking spaces and paved and paver type surfaces. And I just say, you know, appropriately use, you know, vegetation and landscaping and grass and things like that to just appropriately break it up so it's just more visually appealing. It's a softer space. Like I've been up in New England all weekend, and I got to do a lot of thinking about this. Like when I went up, I drove up the Merritt Parkway through Connecticut, and that's just a really pretty highway. There's like nice mowed grass, and they don't have metal barriers. They have, you know, like the wood timber barriers, and it's really well landscaped, it's well treed, and all of the rest areas are like smaller, and there's good landscaping. It's just really pretty. And on my way back, I come down 95, and you stop at the big, you know, first of all, 95, there's no vegetation. It's all completely paved. It's metal barriers. It's, you know, the rest areas, especially as you get closer to New York, are all just like these big paved areas with no vegetation, no breaking up the hard spaces. And that was just, to me, is like whatever the Merritt Parkway was doing and the way they put that together is, in my mind, at some level, that's what I think
we would want to accomplish, like whenever they put these big spaces together, they do the kinds of things in their design that they do on that one highway versus the other. It's just a much more pleasant experience. And I don't know how, what the right word is for that, but.
Yeah. And I think since we're talking about a mixed use parcel, the idea of there being flow between the different uses is appropriate. Yes. Yep. While still, I there's an attractiveness to being in a residential and not staring at a parking lot for a large box store, to be able to separate that out. And so how to balance flow with also the buffers between the areas. Again, I don't know how to do it, but I know that that is an important goal to strive for in order for there be cohesiveness while still not completely separating it out. So it's not a viewed as a large mixed use parcel. So that speaks to, and we're starting to branch in a little bit to the hardscape aspects of it as well. And a few additional thoughts as to the more hardscape nature of this discussion, just four or five or six more bullet points. Amenities within the public spaces shall include landscaped areas, benches, art or cultural features, or focus features, fountains, clocks, etc. Again, Dawn, that I either I stole that from you directly or with the general guidelines that you were providing.
Yeah, sounds familiar.
Every effort should be made to ensure that public spaces are visible and accessible from adjacent roadways. If for example, there is a public space, let's take, for example, an amphitheater, that should be not hidden. It should be viewable to the general public as they pass by so that it doesn't take special knowledge of the parcel to know it's there and to encourage public access to public features. Decorative brick, concrete pavers, or pavement treatments shall be integrated into the main into various areas within the design of the mixed-use parcel. Internal sidewalks shall be designed to give pedestrians a good view of oncoming traffic and shall be located far enough from traffic signs, trees, light fixtures, or other obstacles to prevent interference within pedestrian movement. Again, the emphasis on being, if for example, you have a overlay district where the goal is perhaps by a developer for live, work, play, you'd want the ability to walk the grounds and go between the different areas of that parcel without interference and from a pedestrian standpoint, without any concern for traffic safety, as well as just to create an overall enjoyable environment. And then last, areas adjacent to walkways shall be landscaped for visual interest, shade, and scale. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, add one thing, and I think properly utilize landscaping to buffer. I think you said this before, but buffer the different uses. You know, like Wegmans is going to be a big parking lot, and it's a big building. We all know that. You can't get away from that, right? But if you go to Wegmans over in Princeton, and you're on the access road coming in, they do a good job of before you even get to the retail area, there's just a lot of trees, so it doesn't look, you see the building, but it's just not a big monolith in front of you. You know, there's other interests, there's just visual interest that kind of softens the whole appearance of the size of the place. And you know, and I was happy to see when I did the walkthrough, that big row of trees that's there between the two parcels, they're planning on keeping most of those to help buffer the commercial area from the residential area. And they're just going to cut through like access roads through two parts of it, you know, so that's good. I think, you know, that type of thing, you know, I think when you see when we review the plans, there's going to be one area where we're going to have to make sure that they probably, in the spirit of this, buffer between the, I think was where the CVS was going to be and the apartment closest to the street, because that's the one area right now. There's no existing vegetation between the two areas, you know, things like that. But I think properly doing that, it really softens it. And
you know, I think part of the issues that people are concerned about is you don't want to go in there. You don't want it just to be a big, huge area of nothing but concrete and pavement and big buildings, right? And I think vegetation, as much as anything, helps kind of break that up and soften that up and makes it a more pleasant place to be. And, you know, I'm encouraged by what I've seen so far, but I think for this particular example, but generally we just need to make sure the wording is right so they're encouraged to make those kinds of decisions.
And one additional thought is that everything needs to be ADA accessible.
Yes.
And I'm sure that that's part of the ordinance regardless, and probably doesn't need to be mentioned additionally in the guidelines, but still worth noting.
And I don't know if anyone's been through the corporate centers that have recently been redone. Almost all complete right now.
Oh, cool.
And the Lower Makefield Corporate Center North Campus, I think, turned out really nicely with the way everything was laid out. Let me just share my screen, show you a little picture of that. And you just see that, you know, they, instead of a big parking area that was in the center of the four huge buildings that are out there, you now have more of an open area, sort of plazas where people can gather.
Right.
Walkways to connect between the four buildings, the hotel, the Dunkin' Donuts, some landscaping mixed in with smaller groupings of plants. Some funky modern lighting that they have there that actually looks kind of nice, like eating areas where people can gather. And it came out to be, I think, pretty nice when you take a look at it. Also, for the Corporate Center South Campus, they have sort of their big deck area that they built. It was a parking area between the couple of buildings, and they converted that to be a road that still cuts through, but you have sort of like speed tables in between where you have pedestrian crossings leading from the buildings, and then you have a big multi-level area for people to gather, to sit down, relax. They do have ramps leading to the different levels, and I think they now have railings up there too, so that the whole area is just sort of pedestrian friendly and accessible. And something I think is a nice amenity to the office campus.
It's also nice. You have a lot of open space there, but you in the area of the parking lot, they have included what looks like probably as many trees as they can add to that space. And of course, I'll leave it to the EAC to that. They're the advocates and the best spokespeople for maximizing or minimizing tree depletions and maximizing additional trees on a property. But I think this fits that idea, and the guidelines for landscaping as it applies to the design guidelines going forward should also think to maximize tree use wherever possible, because it benefits not only this parcel, it benefits all of Lower Makefield. And that's an important idea. To me, at least.
And actually, for these two projects, through the approval process, the EAC literally had no comments to offer on either of the site plans for the Corporate Center North Campus or South Campus. They were pleased that they either reduced or mitigated all of the increase in impervious surface, that created more green space, or adding trees, or it's a net gain, and just overall, they just saw the benefit of this project.
Absolutely.
Andy, you had a comment?
Just one thing that I see as an engineer that kind of jumps out at me is that when you're putting trees in hardscaping or in public spaces, you want to use deep-rooted trees, because otherwise then shallow roots would tend to push up the paving. And so that might be something that we want to suggest is deep-rooted plantings
being
in areas where...
It's a good call. Yep.
Yeah, I think anything that lowers... Sorry, Eddie, go ahead.
The only other thing that I was thinking of was, you know, Typically, in the, where you have these public plazas, there's a visual barrier or a visual something that's visually distinctive where it would be a pedestrian area, pedestrian friendly zone. Maybe the paving's different. Maybe there's some colored asphalt. Maybe there's some, you know, stamped asphalt or something that's visually distinctive about the public plaza area or pedestrian friendly zones.
Great. And then I'll also add to the point, Andy, to your last point about tree roots, whenever possible, landscaping materials that are lower maintenance, obviously preferred, because even if it's something visually attractive now, that the developer may not be the owner of that parcel going forward, and therefore may not carry the responsibility of large upkeep, both from a aesthetic appeal as well as from additional chemicals or other materials that would be threatening to the environment or to water sources that could, that might be relied upon too heavily. So that's also something to strive for. Anything else?
Not about what you guys have just talked about tonight, although I think those are all really good ideas. Just since our last meeting, I had the opportunity to go to the where the Wegmans is in Princeton, which Adrian was talking about.
Yeah.
And a little bit, I guess, two or three build storefronts down from that is a Dick's. And what they've recently done, or at least it was the first time I noticed it, is they retrofitted the parking lot and put in two charging stations in the first row right outside the Dick's. Oh, cool. And I know we talked about encouraging developers to put them in. The ones that are put in that parking lot are free. I don't know if that's the norm or if a shopping center or property owners are charging for those sorts of things. Those were at least free. So it may be that not only for new developments, but for redeveloped parking lots that we try and encourage charging stations.
That's great. Good. Well, then, so we have covered all of the sections of the design guidelines that we set out to do so earlier this year. Jim, I guess per your volunteering a few meetings ago, you're gathering the thoughts of what we put forth and going to turn that into some organized document, or am I mistaken?
I know you are correct. And that's something that probably will be probably early December is what I gather.
Great. Well, thank you for your help with that.
Yeah, definitely.
Especially, I want to thank all of you. You gave a lot of good input on everything. And I think we, you know, we had some basis of what we were looking at, and now we've sort of narrowed it down a little bit more. And then once we get a draft, we could look at it and accept or reject any or all of the items that are in there that we think makes sense.
Great.
Hey, Jim, I was wondering if you if your offer to walk the grounds was still open. I know I wasn't able to meet with the developer the couple Mondays ago.
Yes, that's actually was going to be my next thing, that we're starting to get review letters in for the project for the Pricket Preserve, and those will be sent out to everyone next week or so once I get everything all together. And I'm more than happy to walk the site with anyone on the Planning Commission anytime you'd like. I'm generally free to sunset.
Excellent.
Okay.
It's worth it. It was very helpful for me.
Okay.
Dawn, I have to do that too, so maybe we can coordinate.
Yeah, great.
Other business. Any motion for adjournment?
I move to adjourn.
Second. Very good. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Have a wonderful evening, everybody.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Night, thanks everybody. Again, Ross.